I wanted to say thank you, Nick, and thank you, Ilka, because, you know, having this seminar series is really important for, especially for us young researchers. You know, we're trying to establish ourselves, we're trying to make a brand for our research, and having this opportunity to speak to, I don't know, 50, 60, 70 experts, you know, people from the cyanobacteria field, it's really cool. It's a great opportunity. So thank you for putting this together. All right, so about my presentation, I'm here to talk to you a little bit about my work, which centers around cyanobacterial secretion and, you know, why do we want to learn about cyanobacterial secretion, but also how can we apply this, yeah? So I have an introduction slide as well. So my background, as Nick was saying, so I'm originally from Portugal. My first interactions with algae were in ecotoxicology, so I was actually trying to kill them. And then in my master's, I did some wastewater remediation with freshwater algae. So at the time, no cyanobacteria. This was just with green algae. And then I had the opportunity to move to the UK for my PhD. And in the PhD, that's where I gained a lot of tools. And like I started looking for applications because in the UK, research is very application oriented. I did metaproteomics, so, you know, a lot of mass spec experience. And that's first when I gained kind of a passion for this microbial ecology and using algae for applications and stuff. And yeah, I mean, following that passion led me to industry. So I worked for 18 months producing omega-3, you know, just developing a platform. And the company is actually expanding a lot based on that work that we developed in that year and a half. So at the time, it was just starting. Then I did a postdoc at the University of Copenhagen. So this is the lab of Paul-Erik Jensen. And you might know him because of his work on light-driven synthesis that we talked about a couple of weeks ago, actually. And that's also where I was introduced to cyanobacteria. So that's where I started working with cyanobacteria. And I'll present a little bit of that work today. And now, since 2019, I've been a postdoc at the University of Jena. And fortunately, I was able to get a Humboldt Fellowship. So the next 2 years I'm funded on an Alexander von Humboldt Fellowship. So basically cyanobacterial secretion can mean many things, right? So we can be talking about extracellular vesicles. We can look at metabolite secretion, which is also product secretion when we're producing some type of metabolite. Siderophores are an example of secretion. EPS to form biofilms. And also proteins and exoenzymes. And this is actually here, proteins and exoenzymes is actually where I'm going to focus all my work today. But I have several projects here looking at enzymes, T4P, metabolites. So, you know, I'm working on a lot of different areas because for me, it's just really interesting to see how these things are secreted, why they're secreted. So looking at kind of function and regulation of secretion. So moving on. The next couple of slides, I'm going to introduce basically a bit of the fundamentals of protein translocation and protein secretion in cyanobacteria. So from a very basic point of view, if you think of the cyanobacteria cell as a gram-negative bacteria, you can see that the outside of the cell is very similar, right? So we have the plasma membrane, the outer membrane, and the space in between is the periplasm. Of course, we have the cell wall is here, but I'm not depicting the cell wall in these figures. And in bacteria, when we talk about export normally is defined as crossing the plasma membrane, and secretion is actually crossing the outer membrane. Of course, cyanobacteria are special because they have the thylakoid membranes, right? And basically for the thylakoid membranes, we can call that import, but the machinery for export and import, I'll show you in a second, which is the second TAP machinery, they're actually identical. And that's actually, I'm not gonna talk about that today, but that's actually one of the questions that we touch upon in this review that me and Julie wrote recently, is that with identical machinery, how do you target proteins either outside of the cell or inside the thylakoids? So this is an interesting question that some people are also working on. So like I said, if we focus on the plasma membrane, because today we're going to focus on things leaving the cell towards the extracellular space, we see a second TAT. Yeah? And I'm not going to go into much detail, but the essential important aspects is that with SEC, the protein is translocated unfolded. So the protein will fold in the periplasm. And with TAT, the protein is folds in the cytoplasm and gets translocated in a folded state. It's also said that TAT has some type of proofreading ability. So if a protein is misfolded or a protein potentially lacks a cofactor, there is some evidence that shows that TAT might reject the protein. So TAT might also have, not only does it translocate proteins, it might also have some type of proofreading system, although it's not completely clear how this could work. Okay, so we're now in the periplasm. Yeah, we've had just to say that this is dependent normally on signal peptides. So the signal peptide is a small, typically N-terminus sequence that targets the protein to a specific translocation mechanism. So the protein then gets to the periplasm. It has no signal peptide, and it has to engage with other machinery to be secreted. And this is essentially an overview of secretion systems that you can typically find in cyanobacteria. So they're not all present in all cyanobacteria, and we'll talk about that in a second, but this is kind of the variety that we at least know of confidently at the moment. So if we start here from left to right, on the left, we have the type 1 secretion system. And if you came to the talk last week, Dimitri was talking about tripartite systems, and the type 1 secretion system is exactly this. So what we see here is the IMC here, inner membrane component, which is typically an ABC transporter, which has specificity for a metabolite or a protein or something. Then the adapter that connects here, and then it connects to the outer membrane pore, which for the type 1 secretion system, based on homology and structural analysis, we're calling it TOL-C. Of course, TOL-C is also involved in a lot of these other tripartite systems. So it's not only a protein secretion system, it's also a metabolite secretion system. It kind of doubles in function. Then we go here to the T4P, and the T4P is a type 4 pilus. And the type 4 pilus, there's a lot of people working on it at the moment. You have Anagret, you have Conrad, you have Rakafet. You know, there's a lot of work done on the type 4 pilus, a lot of Japanese groups. And essentially what the type 4 pilus is a very complex structure that it spans both membranes, and it incorporates this pilA1, and pilA1 then polymerizes into a pilus that then goes out the cell. And I'll come back to the T4P later in the presentation. Then we have these what is called a conjugation system, but it can also be a protein secretion system, and this is the T4SS. They don't normally exist in our typical lab pets like Senecacystis, Senecococcus. You won't find them, but they are common in more complex cyanos. And I'll mention this in the next slide. And finally, we have the type 5 secretion system. So there are several types, but basically the idea is that these type 5 secretion systems used to be called autotransporters. And why are they called autotransporters? Because they encode either in one protein or in proteins that are normally close to each other on the genome, they encode both the translocation mechanism and the protein that gets released. So you can see in the classical example that this is only one protein that then basically forms a barrel and loops into the barrel and sticks outside the cell. But we can also have a different version that gets cleaved and then released, yet another version that forms a trimer, and then recently there's been discovered more. There's a type 5D, type 5E. So the type 5 secretion system is actually quite an active field of research in bacteria. And almost none of it is known in cyanobacteria, actually. So in this review that we published recently, we actually included a genomic analysis of secretion systems. And what you're seeing here is basically, I have this in a percentage, but it's essentially how many secretion systems were identified per species. And I separate this by morphology, yeah? So what we have here is unicellular, filamentous, heterocystis, ramified, and baeocystis. And the reason why we group it by morphology is that if you look at grouping by phylogeny, it didn't really make much sense how the secretion systems were distributed. But if you look at morphology, actually it makes a lot more sense. And looking at the trends essentially, actually, before I say this, let me just make a point here that this group here is literally only one cyanobacterium. This is only Fischerella thermalis that is ramified in our data set. These are like, they're 20, 25 different ones for the other groups. So if we look at the type 1 secretion system, actually the software didn't identify many in unicellular cyanobacteria, there was a lot more, for example, here in Heterocystis, almost every species had a type 1 secretion system identified. But then when we looked for the outer membrane pore, the TOLC, that was present in almost every species. So it's not clear if these are incomplete systems, or maybe the TOLC would be used only for metabolites and not for proteins. So we're not completely sure if this is a bioinformatic issue or if it's really, you know, really a lack of a type 1 secretion system. And then interestingly, we see the type 4 pili are present in almost every single cyanobacterium. And as you know, some cyanos are competent, some are not, some are motile, some are not, but the T4P is always there. So why it's there, it's an interesting question, actually. Then we look here at the conjugation systems, and this is what I was saying, that the conjugation systems, they typically exist in the more complex cyanobacteria, but not in the simpler ones. So there are some strange unicellular cyanos that do have conjugation systems, but generally the smaller genome ones don't. And then the cool thing, and this is actually interesting, because like I was saying, we know almost nothing about the type 5 secretion systems in cyanobacteria, but there are literally hundreds of them. So here, when this says 200, 300%, this means that actually every species on average had two or three type 5 secretion systems. So this is something that I think there's a big opportunity here to look into, because there's really very little information on this. There's two or three papers, if that. And they're super, super abundant. So there must be some function here for it. And just to give you a bit of background, the type 5 secretion systems, they can be involved in adhesion, outer membrane remodeling, you know, they're quite varied. That's why it's difficult to study, because there's really not like one function for them. And there's no clear, super clear motifs or the protein. So, you know, it can be a bit tricky to describe them. One thing that didn't make it into the paper, but I wanted to mention because I think it's super interesting, is that we also looked at cyanobiont secretion systems. So these are cyanobacteria that live in, sometimes the symbiosis is inseparable, right? So for example, this endosymbiont here of Ropalodia, it has no secretion systems, but I would also debate that maybe this is not clearly a cyanobacteria. This is almost only an organelle now, you know, it's kind of not even close to free living anymore. But if we look at the ones that are a bit more free living, although some in a direct symbiosis, this one is interesting. For example, the Atello cyanobacterium, which used to be the UCYNA, actually doesn't have PS2, right? So it's lost photosystem 2, and it relies on the coccoliths to get what it needs for growing, but it still has a secretion system. So, you know, why has the secretion system not disappeared over time? So these things are quite interesting. And then for others, we also have this cyanobiont of the dinoflagellate that lives under the scales of the dinoflagellate, Richelia, which lives, I think, in the periplasm of the diatom. And then we have Cynococcus, that is a symbiont of a sponge. And this one actually has a T1SS, a T4P, and type 5 secretion systems. So what we see here is that when the cyanobacteria, when they get more streamlined in symbiosis, they do lose some secretion systems. But it's interesting that some stay there. So why at the moment, I don't know, but this is quite an interesting question. So I'm going to change now completely to a different, an older paper. First, I'm going to talk about the biotechnological applications of secretion. And this is something that was published in 2019. And this will lead into the unpublished work that we mentioned in the beginning. So when I was in Copenhagen, we were working with these, what we called light-driven enzymes. And one of them was an LPMO, a polysaccharide monoxygenase that requires electrons to cleave cellulose. But the cool thing about the enzyme is that you can actually drive it using pigments. Yeah? So you can use chlorophyll just to drive the enzyme. So the idea was, could we get the cyanobacterium to secrete the enzyme and kind of fuel it at the same time? So, you know, we managed to secrete it. The cyanobacteria couldn't really fuel it. We still had to give it electrons in a different way. But this was kind of the idea, original idea was to get like a solar powered biomass degrading machine. And the cyanobacterium we used was Cynococcus elongatus, the famous fast-growing mutex. And I won't spend much time, but basically it's very similar to 7942. And from the original paper, you can see that it has quite a big growth difference. And basically the experimental design was we picked up this LPMO from a gram positive bacterium, Thermal diffusive fusca, and then we added we kept the native sex signal peptide, but we also exchanged it for a TAT signal peptide. So at the same time, we wanted to compare secretion through the sec and the TAT system to see if TAT, for some reason, would be better, because this is a protein that has a copper cofactor. So if the copper is not inserted properly or not inserted at all, the enzyme is not active. And essentially, the idea was to see, does the enzyme end up in the periplasm? Does the enzyme end up in the medium? Is it active? So first we did the initial screening, and what we saw was that in the, here on the right, with the TAT signal peptide, we found the protein inside the cell. So these are cell lysates. You can see here a Rubisco marker. And we see that with the sec, the protein was not in the cell. So at the time we were wondering, okay, this could be good or bad news, right? It could be that it's not expressed or it's completely secreted. And this is actually what we found, that the protein with its native signal peptide was secreted almost 100% from the cell. And what was happening with the TAT signal peptide was that the protein basically was not being released from the cell. So we wanted to know a little bit more about what was happening with the TAT signal peptide. So we did some cell fractionation, yeah? And what we did was we started by separating the medium from the periplasm from the spheroplast. So the spheroplast, you can imagine that it's the everything that is in the plasma membrane. So that it's a cyanobacteria without a periplasm and outer membrane. And we can see already the same thing. So with a sex signal peptide, the protein is not inside the cell. But with the TAT, it's accumulating in the spheroplasts, yeah? And you can see dimers, you can see trimers, degradation products. So we went a little bit farther with this, and we did a membrane fractionation. And you can see here, T is the enriched thylakoids, and M is the total membrane. So we didn't do a clean membrane fractionation, but we basically separated a fraction that is richer in thylakoids, and the other fraction is a total membrane. So essentially, if you look at this lane minus the other lane, you're getting more or less what's on the plasma membrane. So it's a difference. And you can see that even in the thylakoids, there was some protein going basically in the wrong direction. So there was some protein that looks like maybe it was going to the thylakoids, but it would be a small fraction. But essentially most of it was found in the plasma membrane. And you can see up here, these are the dimers. And this is both with and without the signal peptide. So you can see here that this is the mature form, this is the uncleaved form. So really the protein was just jamming up the TAT system and just wasn't going through. So this was an interesting observation, but of course for the purpose at the time, it wasn't so good, right? So then we moved on to characterize it with the sec signal peptide, which was the most successful approach. And what we see here is, this is an aureole stain. So it's just, I don't know if it's based on fluorescence, but it's just a very sensitive stain, much more sensitive than Kumasi. And you can see that this is a protein standard that we bought from a company. And you can see that in the medium of the sex strain, you can see that the protein is here. And actually it's almost, if not actually the most abundant thing in the medium. So it was actually really efficiently secreted, almost to a milligram per liter of enzyme in the medium. And it was also interesting to see that when you have the protein being secreted, other proteins become less intense. So you can see the control here. This protein, for example, is less intense in the medium, but this could just be competition for the translocation pathways, right? But we're not completely sure here. Then we had to look to see if the enzyme was actually active, and it was secreted and it was active. And essentially, not to complicate too much, this is just a chromatogram of the degradation of a model substrate, of a model cellulose substrate. And we can see the oxidized standards here in green. And you can see that these blue peaks are actually our product. So you can see that there was a lot of unspecific degradation of the cellulose, but at least where we have the standards, we see our enzyme was working as it should. So this was quite cool. So we could secrete an enzyme to degrade cellulose. This was active. But the question then that I was interested in is that, okay, this is a nice application, but I was actually interested more in the fundamentals of how is the protein secreted from the cell before we go there. quickly just to show that there was very little impact on the health of the cell. So we here in the line, we have the, with the sex signal peptide with the blue line, and with the green with the TAT signal peptide. And even though the protein with the TAT signal peptide was jamming up the membranes, the cells were still growing quite healthily. And there was no effect on pigment production or anything. So actually the secretion had very little phenotype on the cell, at least from the point of view of growth and pigment production. Going back to the question I was saying, we were thinking, okay, how is the protein secreted? And at the time, so it was clear it was a two-step secretion process because it was obviously dependent on crossing the plasma membrane through SEC and TAT. And we know that, for example, the pilins also depend on SEC to be secreted, to form this pilus. And the other thing about the T4P is that this is from a recent review from Fabian Conrad and Annegret, and we see that the T4P subunits are really, really highly homologous to the subunits of the type 2 secretion system in bacteria. And you can see that these colors here are matching basically the same function of these subunits. So we had this idea that it could be the T4P could be involved. There's this homology to the type 2 secretion system. And also this idea that the T4P potentially secretes proteins that are not related to the pilus is also not new, because you can see already 2003 secretion of a colonization factor through the type 4 pilus pathway, 2006 type 4P mediated secretion, 2007. So there is a history of when people knock out the T4P, this affects secretion profiles. But the question that I wanted to answer really is, okay, it's clear that the T4P affects secretion profiles, but is it actually the T4P that is secreting the protein? Is it exactly that pathway? So using the signal peptide from my paper, I established a secretion reporter. And what I decided to use was this nanoleuk luciferase. So this comes from Promega. And the luciferase itself, the sequence is public, so you can clone this. But what is proprietary is their special substrate that makes it really, and this substrate is very, very luminescent. So this is luminescence-based. So the idea is basically you add a secretion signal to the nanoleuk. I expressed it in SNCCcystis, and then it's very easy because you could just spin down a small volume and measure it on a plate reader. So this is very convenient to then look at secretion levels in the medium. And looking at just a small proof of concept, just looking for expression, you can see that with 1 microgram of protein from the medium, I'm getting around 11 million of luminescence. This is several orders of magnitude of difference here that we can measure up and down. Now, to show exactly that, I also did some tests to see, you know, how little volume can we use to detect the luminescence. And you can see here on the left, starting with 50 microliters, we're around 10 to the 7. And at 1.5 microliters, we're still between 10 to the 5 and 10 to the 6. So the interesting thing with this is that you could go down to the nanoliters and still detect signal. So even if you wanted to make this some kind of automatic detection using a robot or something, you could use so little volume that you can do this in anything. You can grow them in plates. It doesn't make a difference. Volume is not a problem for detecting this signal. And you can see that after the signal is developed, it's stable over time. So after you develop it using the substrate, the signal lasts for tens of minutes. And the protein itself is actually stable in the medium for up to 6 days. So it's also no problem. Of course, if you have a lot of proteases in the medium or something, this could be a problem, like any other enzyme. But the protein itself is very stable, especially at 30 degrees. And the cool thing is that we can use in the nanoleuk just by sampling very small volumes of medium. We could use it for really simple secretion time courses. So you can just go into your culture, take a little sample out, measure, and do this every couple of hours. So we can see here on the bottom left, this is every 3 hours, and you can see 3, 6, 9, 12, 24. And it's kind of just stepwise. You see the protein accumulating in the medium, and it's quite cool. And then if you do it every day, over a week, you can see that, and this is not standardized to cell number. So you can see that this kind of follows what typically you would think of a growth curve. So you can also see that the more cells that are there, the more secretion. So you can actually, this is just a really sensitive reporter, and it works really well. So Promega has developed quite a really nice system. So now just to talk to you briefly about the T4P data that I was saying initially, that will go into the paper. Then I got into contact with Anagret and Conrad because they had a lot of T4P mutants from their work with motility and natural competence and things. So they shared a lot of their mutants with me. And all I was doing was essentially picking up their mutants, checking the mutants in my lab, putting the N-loop reporter into the mutants, and then measuring secretion with all of this collection of mutants. And today I'm just going to present here the most important three or four that kind of start to tell the story already. And for reference here, okay, here on the right, we have our T4P system, yes? So we can see here the TRC, this is just the empty vector. We have no secretion. And this is what we're comparing it against. So this says wild type, but it's a wild type N loop. It's a wild type with the nanoluciferase. So first, let's look at the knockout of HFQ. So HFQ here is a protein that connects to PIL-B, and it basically coordinates a lot of the T4P. Well, I think the original description for HFQ in cyanobacteria is from Dennis Deanst in 2008, if I'm not mistaken. And you can see that it kind of regulates the whole system. So when you knock out HFQ, you lose the whole T4P system. And although we don't have that, if you knock out PIL-B1 here, PIL-B1 is the protein that's responsible for extending the pilus. If you knock out PIL-B1, you also lose the entire system. So because HFQ and PIL-B1 interact. So if you knock out one, you essentially lose the function of the other. And what we saw was that when we knocked out HFQ, we lost most of the secretion in the system. So initially, what I thought was that, okay, so it looks like the T4P are responsible for secreting the protein. But here's a little twist now in the story. So if we expected the protein to be secreted through the T4P, it should be pushed out by the major pilin. But actually, when we knock out the major pilin, secretion increases. So what this is basically saying is that somehow the T4P is involved in some co-regulation that affects secretion, but it doesn't look like it's actually physically secreting the protein. And to go a little further, Then we tested it with a PILQ mutant, and the PILQ mutant basically knocks out the outer membrane pore. So this really blocks the entire T4P pathway. And when we knock out PILQ, what we see is that the secretion levels are the same as the wild type. So essentially the story here is that the T4P pathway, although it might be indirectly involved in secretion of the protein, and I'll discuss this in the next slide, it doesn't seem like it is the exact pathway of secretion. So we don't see the same thing as in the type 2 secretion in bacteria, where we have a pilus pushing the protein outside the cell. So really, what is happening? This is not so easy. I just wanted to mention that we also looked at secondary nucleotide messengers like CAMP, and that didn't affect secretion levels because obviously that was one of the obvious things to look at. But what we're thinking at the moment that is happening is that the T4P is a very interconnected system. So it's related to motility, it's related to competence, light sensing. So it's connected to a lot of systems in cyanobacteria. So when you knock out T4P, I think there's a lot of effects throughout the cell. We're causing membrane stress on the plasma membrane because of accumulated pilins that are not processed properly. We're causing effects on the outer membrane biogenesis. This could be also, for example, it could be knocking out HFQ, could be closing several porins. So we think at the moment that when you take a sledgehammer to the whole T4P, it's actually an effect that you see across the whole outside of the cell. But then when you start picking it apart, you know, slowly taking only some proteins out, we see that actually these secretion effects that we see when the whole T4P is knocked out are not because the T4P itself is secreting the protein, but probably due to a lot of side effects. Of course, the side effects can be quite diverse. So this is something that is still for future work, is to try to figure out exactly why these secretion profiles change and why the protein stops to be secreted when we completely eliminate the T4P. I've started writing the manuscript. Hopefully it'll be on bioarchive soon enough so the whole community can take a look. But this was just a small preview. And I'd like to start by acknowledging the group of people that I worked with in Copenhagen. So of course I was working in the group of Paul-Erik Jensen, but we was working with a great group of postdocs, and we were funded by Novozymes and the Novo Nordisk Foundation, and also in collaboration with Roberta Croce and Bart in Amsterdam. And then while in Copenhagen, and then after moving to Germany, I have to acknowledge my funding. So I'm being funded by a postdoc grant from the university called the Impulse Project. My position is funded by the Humboldt Foundation, the Collection of Mutants, and a lot of discussions. I have to acknowledge Conrad and Agret, Fabian, Niels. So they've helped a lot with this Collection of Mutants and sharing these things with me and discussing the data. Julie, who is always there and present in pretty much every paper. And finally, the rest of my group that I think I didn't mention it in the beginning, but I'm the group of Professor Georg Ponert here in Jena. And this is a group picture from when we could still go out in the past. So thank you very much. If you have any questions now, I'm happy to take them. And other than that, you can also contact me at any time. I'm always available for a chat. So yeah, again, thank you.